we recently had this awesome time sitting down with the Hollywood Reporter telling the oral history of Jackass.
Mm-hmm.
I had a blast doing that.
Yeah, that was funny.
But I didn't come away... I always understood that your story was that, like, right out of high school, you moved to L.A. to go become a big movie star.
Yeah, like, well, a month out of high school, I moved out to Los Angeles to attend the American Academy of Dramatic Arts. And for a 6 weeks program, that was my excuse to have my parents let me go to Los Angeles. And I attended the first 2 weeks and didn't go back because I was 18 and in Los Angeles and I was just partying so much. And spent the summer out here, ran through all my money, and my parents convinced me to come home. And I went home for a few months, worked at a restaurant, made some more money, and came back for good in January of 90.
Okay.
When you were working at the restaurant, were you filming stuff or were you just working?
Knox on that. No, I was a busboy.
But like you weren't like, because when did that video of you with the shooting yourself in the chest?
That was like
the,
95?
90. Yeah, 95, 96.
Probably shot in 95 and came out in 96.
Yeah.
Something like that.
Yeah.
That whole bit of like self defense was all included in that.
Or maybe shot 96, came out in 97. But
that
that was the first time you ever had filmed anything, right? Was this?
And I wasn't even going to film it.
Right.
I was going to just write an article, and Tremaine suggested I film it.
As I always understood it, your story, and I describe it that way, is like the Bad Company song, Shooting Star. Is that kind of fair to say? Like,
well, I mean... Well, there were a lot of pills and whiskey beside my bed at one time. But, yeah, I mean, that's your version of it. That's wonderful,
yeah.
I guess.
I love it. I mean, like, Johnny was a schoolboy when he heard his first Beatles song. But like, it's like when you were a schoolboy, you decided you wanted, like, you were in love with the movies. Right? I remember when we were filming the first Jackass movie, you had this, like, I think it was on your iPod. You had, like, old school... like classical movies, like that you're listening to just the audio of it, and I was like, "What are you doing?"
Oh, right. The theme song to Cinema Paradiso, or bits from Casablanca. Yeah, I love it.
Yeah, I mean, like it was crazy. Like, it wasn't music. It was like you're listening to the actual
scenes.
Just the audio of scenes from movies.
Yes.
And I was like so confused by that, and you were like, "Hey, man, I love movies."
Yeah. That's how my family. We ate around the television, either watching television like Sanford and Son or the Andy Griffith Show, or watching films.
Yeah.
So that's how we connected.
You know, just going from there, and it's my version of your story, but it's like, you know, you say, "Mom, I'm going to go away. I'm going to be a big star." You go out to L.A. and
don't do shit for the first 6 years. Besides. I studied a little, but mostly I was partying and spinning my wheels.
I mean, I knew you. I know you wanted to be a big movie star, and you did find some success in television commercials.
Right. Well, when my then girlfriend got pregnant and we had a daughter on the way, that was the point in my life where I decided I have to do something. So
right.
I just started trying to make anything happen, any positive step forwards. So my friend John Linson got me a job writing for magazines like Bikini Magazine, which is now defunct. And my next door neighbor at the time was Antoine Fuqua, and he helped me get a commercial agent. And it's funny because I never really got callbacks before I started writing for magazines. But when I started writing for magazines, it took the pressure off. I'm like, well, I can do this, so I don't have to lean so heavy on this, and it relaxed me on the auditions. Then I started getting callbacks constantly.
Nice.
Mm. Yeah.
It's funny. There was less desperation there.
Yes, and less nervousness.
Uh-huh.
I had such a fear of talking on camera. Like, wow. I remember I wanted to be in, I decided in high school, I wanted to move out to Los Angeles and be in the movies, and we filmed something. They filmed something at my high school my junior year. It was something about, I don't know, they filmed us talking about nutrition. And everyone else was like really good on camera. And I was terrified. I couldn't even say anything. And so it took me a long time to get over that fear of talking on camera.
Hmm.
Were you terrified of talking on camera, Jackass, the first season?
No.
He had it by then.
You had it by
then?
Yeah,
no, by the time I filmed the self-defense equipment bit,
you're pretty
comfortable. I was totally comfortable, yeah.
Yeah.
But when you're so you get the job writing for Big Brother.
I will say, I'll come back to this.
Sure.
With my friends filming.
Yeah.
I would still get nervous walking on a Hollywood movie set, thinking I'm going to get fired at any second. Like the read-throughs.
I thought you were going to say, like The Ringer.
No! Hey! I like The Ringer.
I like The Ringer. Theaters. I like that.
So what was your...
I was just going to say, because I never really thought of it this way, but when you're writing for Big Brother, in your head, are you still like, I'm just going to do this while I try to become a serious actor? Like, the whole time, this was
kind of
just like a day job while you're still pursuing being an actor.
I was trying to pursue both. Whatever clicked first, that's what I wanted.
Cool. Okay.
Yeah, so you've got some television commercials going. You're writing for magazines, but you really as I understand it, my version of your story is that you just kind of felt like, okay, man, now it's time to really make something happen. I'm gonna put myself on the map, and that was kind of what the self-defense equipment was. It was like a big thing to just get the attention, get the ball going. And so you've got this idea, and you're going to do a product review of self-defense equipment with the red pepper spray point blank in the eyes, the stun gun, the taser gun. And what the world didn't know about was the Smith & Wesson 38 caliber handgun. The plan was you're going to shoot yourself with a bulletproof vest on. And then people don't know that because MTV wouldn't show that part. But that's really the pivotal moment where everything... that's the thing.
Yeah, that's what clicked for me. And I felt like, also, when I got to Big Brother, I felt like it was a special group of guys. But the self-defense equipment was the first time in my life where I felt like I had momentum.
Yeah. Mm. Were you introduced to Big Brother in a professional capacity before the self-defense equipment?
I met Jeff on a video that Spike was directing for for Wax, right?
Okay.
And I only remember this because it was the day of the Oklahoma City bombing. We're all on the set and we heard that and we're like, oh, Jesus. So that stuck in my head that's the first day I met Jeff. And I think a year or so goes by, and I went down to World Industries to meet with them because I was writing for mags by that point. Uh-huh. It was a skateboarding magazine, and I didn't have any idea what to write for a skateboarding magazine because I didn't skate. So it wasn't until I had the self-defense equipment idea that I was like, oh, maybe that's something they might like.
Right. Oh, man. And then I remember seeing you in Big Brother magazine with the self-defense, and then in the bull ring. Like, you were doing stuff with bulls just for the pages of Big Brother.
I was just trying to think of ideas. But I was disappointed in myself that day because I went up to Gary LaFue's ranch in Napomo, California, and I got on a so-so bull.
Uh-huh.
Right? He had other bulls, but I got on a so-so bull, and I felt like a real failure. Right? And after that, because he said he had a bull up there named Mr. Mean that, like, even the cowboys hated to ride. And so that stuck in my head, and when we decided to do the show, I'm like, I have to get my self-respect back and get on Mr. Mean.
Only you think of it that way. Can you tell us about that my favorite thing you ever wrote for Big Brother magazine, which was where you had you were posing as an agent prank calling professional skateboarders.
Oh, right. And getting them to do like silly Campbell soup commercials.
Right.
Yeah,
he was calling like the biggest names in skateboarding, saying, I'm an agent and I've got I've got something I think you'd be perfect for. And it was just like the worst look of, pitching them like, and would you be comfortable with your shirt off? Like, these pro skaters say, oh, yeah, totally, man. Like, he was saying, how do you look with your shirt off? Like, yeah, man, I'm pretty ripped.